Welcome to this presentation. It's going to be a high-level introduction into IMS, Voice over LTE, and Voice over Wi-Fi. High-level introduction really is that. So I'll cover like how it all works together. We will not look at low-level details of transactions. By the way, I'm not reading the chat since I only have a single screen, which is shared right now, which you can see. So if you have questions, please open the mic and draw my attention, otherwise I won't notice it. Okay, so yeah, what this talk is about, IMS basics, what is IMS to begin with, how is it used in LTE, in voice over LTE, and how is it used in voice over Wi-Fi? So if you look a bit about the historic evolution of telephone signaling, there's, of course, the traditional circuit switched technologies, such as the public switched telephony network with analog lines, later extended by ISDN, specifically the Q931-based call control in the subscriber interface on the last mile, and in the core network, the ISUB protocol, part of the SS7 stack for signaling circuit switched voice calls. GSM inherited that and uses a layer 3 call control, which is derived from Q931, so taking the ISDN history there. And in the core network, mostly it's the so-called BICC, the bearer independent call control protocol that is spoken between core network elements or also ISUB in traditional circuit switched cellular networks. In terms of packet switched telephone signaling, there is H323, which is an ITU standard that draws a lot from the traditional circuit switched ITU telephone signaling, so you can see a history there. On the other hand, there is IETF SIP, Session Initiation Protocol, that is luckily become the dominant standard in voice over IP telephony on the internet. ITU then picked that up again and specified something they call SIP-I, which is an ISUB replacement in telco networks, which has all kinds of weird additions to SIP, but it is still fundamentally SIP. And then we have the 3GPP IMS, the IP multimedia system, which also is based on SIP signaling, but again with some derivations of original or plain SIP. So what is this IP multimedia system? First of all, it's important to understand the historic context. It predates LTE, so it was not designed as an as a voice technology over packet switched only LTE cellular network, but it was specified at the time when 2G and 3G were out there. And you can actually see that they added a lot to the 2G and 3G specs on the packet switch side to make IMS possible over these older technologies. So if some of you ever have looked at the packet switch related protocol specs, you will find that there is lots of add-on when we are finished with this talk that makes sense, which was added onto these older technologies to make IMS, at least in spec and in theory, work over those technologies. I'm not aware of anyone really using it that way, but it's specified. The idea of IMS was to do some kind of grand unified packet switched telephony system, which works over IP-based systems such as GPRS or UMTS at the time in the cellular domain, but also to include options for, let's say, land-based telephony. So the idea was that a telco can operate an IMS core, which is used both by cellular telephony over packet switched and also by wired systems such as cable modems or DSL modems, and have one unified core network, which is the IP multimedia system. That has then been later extended to be used in Volte and voice over Wi-Fi, both of which are really marketing terms. They are not really 3GPP technical or spec terms for using IMS over a certain access network. In the case of voice over LTE, it's IMS over an LTE network. In case of voice over Wi-Fi, it is IMS over what is called untrusted networks, which in the you have to take the point of view of the telecom operator, which means it is an access network that is not operated by them, right? In the case of 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G, those access networks are considered trusted by the telecom operator because they operate this network themselves, and anything outside of that is an untrusted network. And that's what voice over Wi-Fi is described as. There's also VONR, voice over new radio, which is basically IMS over 5G access network, which is not really any different than IMS over an LTE access network. If you look at it, it's the same in the end. So what is IMS? If we look at a basic IMS core network, of course, it can be much more complicated. And also, I should iterate that I'm not an IMS expert, and this is only a high-level overview, so lots of details that we ignore to simplify the situation. But as a like high-level view on it, you basically have a set of SIP proxies and also in cases back-to-back user agents or session border controllers, how they are called. It's mainly the so-called CSCF network elements. There's the PCSCF, the ICSCF, and the SCSCF. I guess nobody thought about pronounceable acronyms in IMS, unlike in the radio access technologies. And in addition to that, you have the HSS, the Home Subscriber Server, which is the central subscriber configuration database, like in the LTE access network or core network. You have the Home Subscriber Server that stores the credentials, the cryptographic authentication details of the subscriber. It stores the SIP URIs, which means the MSISDN, the telephone number of the subscriber, and all kinds of other details. What kind of services the subscriber is permitted to use, what kind of supplementary services, and so on. So whatever was stored in the HLR before in the circuit switch domain is now stored in the HSS. And the IMS is also using the HSS to store configuration. So in the subscribers somehow connect over SIP to the PCSCF, the proxy CSCF, and then this gets forwarded. We will look at this in more detail. But essentially, we have these CSCFs that inquire the HSS and that are connected over some access network, which we ignore in this initial part of the presentation, to the CSCFs. So what is a CSCF? It's a call session control function. And the PCSCF is the proxy call session control function. In the end, it is the IP address to which an IMS client sends SIP traffic. It's really only at the IP level. So in the SIP headers, you will usually not have the PCSCF as the destination of your SIP transaction. But on the IP level, it is where the SIP traffic is being sent to. So it's really a proxy for SIP traffic. It also serves as an IPsec endpoint in case of Volte, not in the case of voice over Wi-Fi. And it forwards the SIP traffic to the ICSCF. Now, if you think, well, what's the purpose of having a separate function if it only forwards it to the ICSCF? Well, this only looks at the simple case where we have a non-roaming situation where basically the subscriber is part of the same network, not an inbound roaming subscriber. And also it ignores the emergency call situation where there is yet another ECSCF, the emergency call session control function. So we ignore all of that and we just assume for the simple case, all the SIP traffic that enters at the PCSCF gets forwarded to the ICSCF. Now, the ICSCF is the interrogating call session control function, which really only has a single purpose, which is to find out which SCSCF shall be used to serve the subscriber. And that involves interrogation of the home subscriber service using the diameter protocol, And once it has resolved, what is the SCSCF, which is the serving, core session control function, then it forwards the SIP traffic again to this SCSCF. There may also be multiple HSS responsible depending on the IMSI of the subscriber, so there might be some additional resolution of which HSS to talk to. But again, for the simple case, we assume there is one HSS and that is interrogated by directly by the SCSCF. Once it has figured out which is the SCSCF, the call or the SIP communication ends up there. And that is, yeah, it's a service, not the serving, which I find quite confusing since an SGSN is a serving GPRS support node, and in IMS it's service and not serving. Anyway, it is sort of the anchor to which the subscriber actually registers with a SIP register message, and also where all the SIP traffic ends up. So if you send an invite or something, the PCSCF and the ICSCF just forward the SIP traffic. It ends up at the SCSCF. SCSCF is also inquiring the HSS via diameter to obtain authorization. Is the subscriber permitted to make an outbound call, for example, and so on. It's also in charge of the actual call control then from this point onwards. So it's the actual workhorse. The other two are really just intermediate proxies. The SIP dialect that is used in IMS is not just plain old SIP, like you know it maybe from looking at the VoIP client in Wireshark. There are all kinds of 3GPP specific additions and extensions to the SIP dialect that is used there. The primary example is that there's an introduction of EAP AKA. So EAP is the Extensible Authentication Protocol, AKA is Authentication and Key Agreement, which is the method of authenticating 3G, 4G, 5G subscribers in a cellular network using an iSIM or USIM card. And they have integrated this authentication mechanism into SIP. So that you can authenticate as a SIP user to your SIP registry with this mutual authentication mechanism between the SIM or iSIM USIM card and the IMS core network. And that authentication is completely independent of any kind of authentication that may happen on the access network. So if you have a voice over LTE, there is an authentication involving the SIM card on the radio on the LTE network, and there's yet another level of authentication on the IMS level on top, since those two are completely disconnected. There are other modifications to SIP. Some weird non-standard ways how to indicate whether the terminal supports only voice calls or also video calls, and lengthy list. I'll spare you the details there. So that's basically the IMS as it is, the pure IMS itself. Now, if we look at how this is used in voice over Wi-Fi, I'm using that case because it's a simpler case compared to voice over LTE. We have the IMS core network here with the PCSCF, ICSCF, and SCSCF, as we have just discussed here. They talk to an HSS over diameter, which is not part of the IMS core. It's the same HSS normally that you also use maybe for your LTE or whatever other authentication that may happen in a telco network. And we have a new additional network element, the so-called EPDG, the Evolved Packet Data Gateway. That's a new network element, and it sits between your subscriber and the IMS core is this EPDG gateway. And on the subscriber side, basically, you have an IPsec association here between the subscriber, which is basically the user equipment, the phone or modem, and this EPDG. And the EPDG has a public IP address on the public internet. So unlike all the other network elements in telco core networks, which have only internal IP addresses and private IP addresses, this is at least one interface is publicly exposed here of the EPDG. So using any internet access technology, including Wi-Fi, but of course not restricted to Wi-Fi, any kind of public internet access, you can establish an IPsec tunnel here to the EPDG, authenticate again using the iSIM or USIM card in the terminal, set up IPsec security associations, and then once that is set up, you can talk SIP over TCP IP, also over UDP, but in practice, it's mostly TCP, to the PCSCF, which will forward it to the ICSCF, which will forward it to the SCSCF, and so on. And you go on what we have just discussed about the IMS core. So there's nothing really specific to Wi-Fi in all of this. It's just a marketing term. And that's why I prefer the 3GPP terminology about untrusted non-3GPP access to a 3GPP network in this case. The EPDG from the core network side, it looks a bit like a PGW because sort of you have some kind of tunnel from a mobile phone, from a subscriber to a gateway in the core network. And basically you break out traffic to somewhere else. In this case, it somewhere else is a private IP network of the operator and not the public internet. But it's similar in spirit, you could say, and also it has similar interactions over diameter with the home subscriber server, the HSS. The EPDG IP address, that's now an interesting question. How does the subscriber know to which public IP address on the internet to connect to this EPDG to establish voice over Wi-Fi services? Well, it could be hard-coded in the firmware, or it could be somehow configurable in the user equipment, or there is a DNS-based resolution mechanism where basically there is a public DNS zone. So the 3GPPnetwork.org normally only has internal DNS records that are resolved in the GRX or IPX in the backbone between the operators, but this pub subdomain of 3GPPnetwork.org is actually a public DNS domain that you can query from the public internet. And then there are subdomains for the mobile country code, for the mobile network code. So the XXXYYY is replaced by the MCC and MNC of the IMSI of the subscriber. And then you put EPC for the Evolved Packet Core in front and EPDG for the Evolved Packet Data Gateway. And if you resolve that, you will get one or multiple IP addresses, and then you establish your IKE phase one and later IKE phase two set up these IPsec security associations to the EPDG. In this case, since it's over untrusted public internet, both encryption and integrity protection of IPsec are used. So you won't be able to look at the plain text if you look at the protocol trace between a voice over Wi-Fi device and the EPDG. Also, typically, NetT is used, net traversal of IPsec. That means you don't use ESP in IP, but you use ESP and UDP in IP to traverse across various weird net devices and firewalls that are not aware of IPsec, despite IPsec being, I don't know, 25 years old or so by now. Okay, so that's voice over Wi-Fi in a nutshell. If we look at voice over LTE, then you could assume that it's basically whatever we discussed before, but just using LTE as an access network. I mean, if the EPDG is reachable from public internet, you could just also establish IPsec from LTE that allows you to access public internet and then go to the EPDG. But of course, that would be too simple. And if something is a 3GPP specification, it needs to be complex. And since Evolved Packet Core, which is the LTE core network, supports quality of service or the entire Evolved Packet system, including the RAN, we must make use of that, which means we actually create multiple so-called dedicated bearers with different quality of service for different IP flows. When you attach to an LTE network, you always have a so-called default bearer, which is your background public IP internet access. And it is negotiated with a QCI, which is a QoS identifier, class identifier, I think it is, QoS class identifier, with 8 or 9. And then if you use voice over LTE, you will have two additional dedicated barriers. One is for IMS signaling, which has a high reliability, but no real latency constraints using QCI-5. And then when you do an actual voice call, you will have yet another additional dedicated barrier, which has a low latency, but possibly lossy configuration with QCI-1. For the voice over IP RTP frames in this case. So when you do your IMS registration, then this establishes the QCI-5 bearer. And when you do a call setup, it establishes the QCI-1 bearer at that time. Now, what are those bearers? Let's look at EPS bearers. In 2G, 3G, people know PDP contexts, and the PDP context is basically the IP tunnel between your mobile station, your user equipment, and the GDSN. You can already establish, even in legacy 2G, multiple concurrent PDP contexts to different GDSNs, each of those with its own IP address. However, LTE adds another flavor to this, which is the notion of EPS bearers and TFTs. And you can think of those as subflows within a PDP context. So you connect to one APN, but you have multiple concurrent EPS bearers, each associated with different traffic flows. And those traffic flows are specified by a set of packet filter rules that determine which to which bearer a given packet gets mapped. And those packet filter rules are called TFTs, traffic flow templates. So when you establish an IMS bearer for the signaling, or rather an EPS bearer for IMS signaling, then those packet filter rules would specify your SIP and basically your IPsec traffic over SIP IPsec traffic for the signaling. And then when you establish a call, you would have another EPS bearer with different TFT that would cover the RTP voice data, RTP encapsulated voice data that can get then mapped to another EPS bearer. And that, of course, these bearers, I mean, it makes a lot of sense because even in a highly congested network where everybody watches YouTube or whatever videos, you still want to have decent voice quality, and you don't want the voice quality to deteriorate, and that's why you separate those in a QoS level. So if we put this in a larger diagram together, we basically have our subscriber, which has multiple EPS bearers to the packet gateway. So we have the entire LTE network here abstracted away in this diagram. So of course you have your eNodeB, your MME, your SGW, and so on. But at some point you have the PGW for IMS, where you establish your EPS bearers, and then out of this PGW comes the SIP TCP/IP traffic, optionally with IPsec, towards the IMS core. Of course, the PGW needs to talk to diameter to talks via diameter to the PCRF and to the home subscriber service to check if you actually have permission to use this APN and so on. And the PCRF also has additional important functionality that is associated with the IMS core, because of course, if you have a mobile originated call, then it's relatively easy to establish all those additional dedicated bearers for your user plane. But if you have a mobile terminated call, of course, that mobile terminated call happens, the mobile terminated leg is created here in the IMS core. And then the IMS core somehow needs to trigger that between your UE and the PGW, some new additional bearers are established. And in all the intermediate equipment, of course, down to the eNodeB, so some low latency bearer for your voice or video is allocated. And all of that happens here in the route between the IMS core, the PCRF, and the PGW to establish those additional bearers. And that's sort of why Volte is so much more complicated than normal IMS, or that even voice over Wi-Fi. And with that high level walkthrough, that really was what the message I wanted to get across. There's a couple of tools. I didn't put links there, but you can easily find those. Well, there's only one. There's this cryptic project called SWUIQV2. That's a Python implementation of the client side of doing everything to establish a connection to the EPDG. So that's the voice for voice over Wi-Fi. So this tool basically implements all this IPsec establishing with the custom 3GPP specific extensions to Ike, and it also can access a PCSC reader for your USIM card, and it will establish this IPsec tunnel to the EPDG, and then you can start sending and receiving SIP to the IMS core. If you want to experiment with that, it's a rather nice project. If you look at the code, I think it's a bit of a hack, and but I mean, it does what it needs to do as a proof of concept to get you access to that. On the core network side, there is FHOSS, which is an HSS that implements the IMS-related features and procedures. It's developed in Java. There's Camaleo as a SIP soft switch that can serve as the PI and SCSCF functions of an LTE core. There's a nice tutorial from Supreeth Herle, who put together a tutorial on how to set up IMS with Open5GS using FHOSS and Camaleo as the IMS core network. And again, on the client side, there is a library called Dubango, which is a portable C++ or C library implementing IMS client functionality. And there's an Android client using that library called IMS Droid. There's also an iOS and an Windows Mobile or whatever it is called. I think it's Windows Mobile or was Windows Mobile at the time. Where this client was created with the Dubango framework. And all of those are open source. You can find those if you look for it. And with that, it was a relatively short presentation, but it was only supposed to be a high-level overview anyway. So... I will be very happy to take questions or elaborate on some topics. So Matt already put the first question there. What types of information are included in the real-world TFT, IP source designation and protocol, or other information? It's mostly really the IPsec Security Association, because when you establish the IPsec, I've only really looked at very few different operators, but at least those where I looked at, they did put IPsec with authentication, not with encryption, but with integrity protection authentication, even over voice over LTE. And in that case, then you have basically the IPsec SPI, I think it's the security policy identifier and you create IPsec security associations separately for the user and for the control plane, and then the TFTs would mostly match on the IPsec SPIs of those different flows. Yeah, these differences between those CSCFs, don't ask me why they created it that way. So the question can I ask what the difference between the ICSCF, PCSF, and the if the ICSCF just forwards all messages to the SCSCF? I think the PCSCF really is mostly just that you have a distinguishable external endpoint that also handles the IPsec part, and then it routes to whatever the PCSCF is responsible, and that may differ whether it's a home network or a roaming network, and also whether it's an emergency call or not an emergency call. But if it's in a home network and it's a non-emergency call, it forwards it to the ICSCF, and then the ICSCF figures out which is the serving the service CSCF. I don't know why they split it up that way. It seems a bit academic and arbitrary, but that's the way how it was done. I'm sure there are reasons that I haven't understood yet exactly.
Hi, Harold. You mentioned hard-coded IP address information for the evolved PDG thing in some cases. Does that for voice over untrusted networks, does that preclude, in maybe in some cases, the possibility to use that user equipment with one's own IMS infrastructure?
In theory, yes, but I mean, it's all only a destination NAT away if that is the case, right? So if there is a hard-coded IP address, you can always have a firewall or NAT in between that does a destination NAT based on that IP address on your own EPDG. And the authentication is exclusively based on the SIM card. So if you issue your own SIM card and you have the matching keys on your own voice over Wi-Fi network, then it will work. So I don't see a blocker there just because there may be, I mean, I personally don't know devices that have hard-coded IP addresses. I'm not an expert on the user equipment side anyway. I just read that this may be the case. And if it is the case, we can work around it via DNAT if necessary.
Yeah. Okay, thanks.
So maybe let me add a bit more, but I don't have slides for this particular topic. Of course, there's more to the IMS core. This really is just the most basic presentation or the most basic functionality. There are other possible functions in the IMS core related to voice over LTE or voice over Wi-Fi. Notably, of course, there is an option to also do SMS over IMS, which is necessary for backwards compatibility if you have a pure 4G, 5G network without any legacy 2G, 3G network, then you need some way to send or receive SMS, which is done over SIP. And then you have SMS PDUs, Base64 encoded inside SIP messages, which is, of course, an enormously useful representation, having a binary put in Base64 put into textual encoding. There is also support for supplementary services. Those who have been looking at legacy cellular and also ISDN networks, supplementary services such as like multi-party calls, three-way, put calls on hold, retrieve, all kinds of supplementary services. Those are also possible in IMS. Interestingly, they then added some XML and HTTP-based protocol. I haven't really looked at it. It's called XCAP. So there's an additional protocol that bypasses somehow the SIP, as far as I understood, but I haven't really looked at this in detail. How that is implemented, I just found it rather weird that you add a completely different protocol stack for those. In addition, of course, in an IMS core, you also may have actual gateways, media gateways for circuit switch technologies to connect to older circuit switch networks, whether it's circuit switched wired networks or it's circuit switched 2G, 3G network core elements. And then these media gateways are controlled by the CSCFs to the interworking. Yes, Matt brings up the top for SMS. Since the SMS is embedded in the SIP control plane, I assume there isn't a dedicated bearer setup. Yes, that's correct. I mean, there's no SIP invite or something like that for the no call setup for SMS. It's really just, I think it's a SIP. What is the message type? There's a SIP message type in which this is embedded when the SMS, yeah, SIP message, then it is, yeah, too simple. where it's added, and yes, that goes over the same bearer as the control traffic. Just like in classic GSM, an SMS goes over the control channel and not over traffic channel. Yeah, of course. Calling a message type message is, of course, yeah, well. Did you see that SIP message? I didn't really touch the user plane much yet in the presentation. Maybe also worth mentioning that there are some requirements. So IMS is rather generic, but in terms of Volte, for example, it is specified which codecs at least minimally any Volte-capable handset must support, and that's narrowband AMR and wideband AMR are the two mandatory codecs, I think, with all the different bit rates that exist in AMR and wideband AMR. And So any user equipment must support those codecs, and thereby interoperability can be established. There are also a couple of other additional bits that are optional, let's say from maybe they're mandatory from the spec point of view, but you can operate without those. There is something about SIP compression in there to reduce the message size, which I find rather esoteric in 4G and 5G. Maybe it made sense at the time where they were planning to do this over GPRS. But I mean, the text encoding of SIP, of course, isn't really a lot of overhead there if you look at 4G, 5G networks and the kind of bandwidth they offer.